Welcome to Brookdale's Writers Series. I'm your host, Jeff Ford. And today with me is Kim Deitch, underground cartoonist, graphic novelist. And we're going to be talking to him about his most recent work, Boulevard of Broken Dreams, and his career in comics. Kim, the first thing I want to ask you is, you grew up in a situation where you were influenced by people who were artists and so forth. What was that like when you grew up? How did that influence your work later on, or got you? How did you get started in comics?
Well, it influenced me terrifically because you're absolutely right. I grew up in a really great cultural atmosphere. My father was in the animated cartoon business, but beyond that, he was a great lover of comics. And like at one point in my early life, he was actually doing a syndicated comic strip, moonlighting from the animation studio. So not only was Dad home upstairs drawing comics, but you know, when you draw comics, there's an awful lot of time where, you know, there's tedious busy work and you're only too happy to have somebody to talk to if they're hanging around. So actually, it was terrific, you know. I'd watch him do stuff and he'd show me how it was done and just tell me a lot about not only how the comics were done, but, you know, the whole tradition of comics. Like, for instance, another thing, and this was fantastic. When I was a kid, my father wanted to keep up with the competition. He subscribed to enough out-of-town newspapers so that I got to see everything that was coming out in comics. Everything, you know, not that I read it all, but it was all there for me to look at.
Well, with most of the things that you looked at, I know he worked for Terrytoons. Is that correct?
Yeah, he ran Terrytoons for a couple of years, and that was pretty amazing too.
Yeah, and most of the things that you looked at, were they mostly panel cartoons? Or were you looking at comic books at that time also?
Oh, well, I was also looking at comic books, but my father took a somewhat less enlightened attitude about those. I mean, he subscribed to Pogo. That was considered a good comic, and he bought all the Peanuts books, and they were good comics. Although, I'll tell you an interesting story. Like so many people who have gotten into comics, one of the big influences when I was growing up was Mad Comics. Not Mad Magazine, but before it was a magazine, it was a comic book. And, you know, it was pretty raw, especially for those days.
Right.
And, like, you know, the first few issues I got of it, I actually, you know, I looked them over. I remember bringing home the one that had, like, the setup of Archie called Starchy.
Yeah.
And, you know, where they've got blackjacks and stuff. And I had it hidden under the mattress. My mother found it, you know, and she came, you know, Kim, I'm going to talk to you, you know. I'm really shocked that you have this, and I really can't allow this comic book anymore in the house. And so I wasn't allowed to read Mad, but the scene changes, you know, and we're on vacation in Pennsylvania somewhere. And then the issue comes out that they do a send-up on Gasoline Alley called Gasoline Valley, which was a particularly brilliant thing that Will Elder did. And so, you know, I'm looking at it wistfully on the stand, and my father comes over and he's looking at it too, and we're both digging it because he's got this Frank King style down to a T.
Right.
And then my mother comes over and she goes, Kim, you know you're not supposed to read that book. And my father, this is the only time I ever saw him stand up to my mother, he went, that's all right, Marie. This is a good book. He could read this, you know, and that was the end of that conversation. And better than that, you know, about, I guess maybe 4 months later, Harvey Kurtzman actually wrote to my old man because of his animation work and sent him, like, the better portion of all the Mad Comics to get him interested in the idea of maybe doing an animation project. And my father gave them all to me.
Do you still have them?
No, you know, but it's amazing how long they lasted, getting more and more tattered. Yeah. I mean, I think about the last one that was just practically falling apart was that very Gasoline Alley issue, which had Alice in Wonderland on the cover. It was about the last one I had before it just completely decomposed.
Was that the time of Tales from the Crypt?
And
yeah, did you get to
was.
See any of that EC stuff?
I saw them. I was less enthusiastic about them. That was more like dope, you know. I'd secretly read them, and then you know, I'd be embedded at night, and I'd get the horrors, you know. It was like, you know, it's like you're getting a hangover, you know, of like, you know. And then I was going, like, oh, why did I read it? Why did I?
When did you start making comics yourself?
I drifted into it around 1966. I was starting to experiment with doing sort of semi-abstract artwork, and I was even having some success selling it in galleries. But what happened was my brother, unlike me, my younger brother, he never really stopped reading comics, and so I wouldn't have been aware of some of the things that were going on, but he'd like come to me and show me like the first issue of Spider-Man, the first issue of the Fantastic Four and stuff. So I was sort of being kept up with it, even while I was doing this other stuff, so that at a certain point I was feeling like, you know, this painting is all right, but it isn't entirely satisfying to me. It's like, you know, the component of writing would be so much niftier. And I think it even started happening before I realized it. It was like the paintings and formal artwork I was doing really started evolving into comic strips, until one day I'm holding a black and white comic strip in my hand, you know, and I haven't quite even realized how it happened. And at about that time, I was showing some of this stuff to some people at the straight job where I was working, and they were going, hey, you know, this stuff is, this is better than Captain High in that underground newspaper, the East Village Other, you know, and I said, yeah. Oh, well, yeah, what's that? And, you know, and so I went and took a look, and, you know, yeah, you know, I may not be the world's greatest artist, but I actually do think I could compete with this guy. And so at a certain point, I had about $500 saved up. Imagine you could do this now. And so I quit my job and went down to the Lower East Side on $500. And within about 10 days, I was working for the East Village Other. However, it must be said, I was working at the East Village Other for no money. You know?
It's a good job.
Figuring out how to make money another thing. I'm still working on that one.
At that time, I mean, when I look back and I read about that time now, you get the impression, reading about it from now, that you guys invented this stuff. I mean, you and Robert Crumb and Spain and Bill Griffith. But were there antecedents to the kind of work that you did? Like just to let people know, the alternate comics dealt with things beyond superheroes, dealt with issues of, you know, for more of an adult audience, involving sex, involving real, you know, psychological issues, dramatic issues, and so mm-hmm. forth. I mean, were there antecedents to that you had seen? I suppose somebody was doing similar stuff in the East Village Other that you saw.
Yeah, well, I saw Captain High in some of the earlier strips, but there were antecedents. I mean, you know, getting back to Harvey Kurtzman, he was a distinct antecedent
right.
because after Mad, he did a series of other magazines, culminating in one called Help. And in Help, I actually saw the early work of Gilbert Shelton.
Right.
I saw panel cartoons by Jay Lynch, and most important of all, early things by Crumb. So that was going on. And another antecedent was Wallace Wood, another one of the EC artists.
Right.
Just about the time I was getting interested in comics, he was doing a magazine called Wit's End, in which he was really trying to expand what comics were into something more interesting, because obviously, or maybe not so obviously, but at the time we got into comics, they were really in this kind of curious state of arrested development. I mean, comics came along about the same time as movies, but they didn't really evolve that much over the years. And they were ripe for, you know, somebody to go in and make the obvious experiments in terms of, you know, turning them into something that more closely resembled real literature.
Right. What would you say would be the, could you point to a distinction between the work of somebody like yourself or Crumb, and the work of that, like Elder was doing, or Wally Wood? You know, there seems to be kind of a break. Was it like the drug culture that came along?
That might have been part of it.
Yeah.
But more of it was just that they were doing commercial work, and what we were doing, at least at that time, wasn't really commercial work.
Right.
Also, you know, the drug culture and just the way the world was kind of turning upside down in the 60s definitely was a big contributor to it all.
Right.
And anyway, you know, like, we knew a lot of those guys anyway. You know, I ran into Kurtzman, and more importantly, Wally Wood. I used to see him all the time, and he was all for what we were doing and extremely encouraging. I mean, that was one of the kind of neat things about breaking into comics. And something that's always stayed with me was the fact that you'd think, okay, here we come, and we're doing this raucous, off-color stuff. You know, the older guys, you think they're going to hate us. That wasn't the case at all. I mean, it was really amazing how well I got treated by the generation just ahead of us.
Did you have a sense that these are some of the things they would have liked to have done?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, you know, they were very nice and very encouraging, you know, and I've tried to carry that on now that I'm of a certain age, you know, like when young kids come to me, I just remember, hey, you know, those guys treated you right, you know, carry the torch, man.
Well, when you were in that situation, I guess in the late 60s, and you were... I guess you were making no money at the East Village.
At a certain point, I read somewhere
where you were living with Spain in some hotel, apartment.
Yeah,
house
right across from Tompkins Square.
Did you have a sense that you were in the middle of something amazing? I mean, because when people
look
back at this time now, it's a very historic moment in comics. You know, especially people who are into people now like Klaus and Chris Ware, they look back at this as kind of a golden age of alternative comics. Were you aware of that at the time?
It was not at all lost on me. I was hoping for something to come along like that. I mean, you know, part of what I'm going to talk about tonight is, like, when I was growing up, what I really wanted to do was make movies. But when I was coming into my adult life, it was clear that movies were really this kind of old, stodgy, monolithic thing, you know? And it wasn't like, you know, you were getting in on the ground floor or something. And so when this comics thing really sort of seemed to be waking up out of a lethargic sleep, you know, I knew, I said, this is a miracle. This is the miracle I was really hoping would come along, but I really didn't expect to come along.
Right.
And, you know, I definitely tried to take as much advantage of it as I could, you know, and I think ultimately I did. I mean, at the time I was living pretty wild, but at a certain point I wised up, cleaned up my act, and I definitely consider it a real miracle to have been able to participate in that. I mean, it was really amazing how you said, like, we almost invented it. It really was like, you know, all of us independently invented underground comics because it was just so clearly in the air at that time.
Yeah. I guess Crum was hugely influential at the time.
He was. Well, you know, I hadn't seen Crum at first. I mean, when I first saw Crum, it was shocking. Because, you know, I was feeling like I was pretty hot stuff up to that point. When I saw Crum, my first reaction was, that's it. I'm out of here. I mean, I can't compete with this guy, you know. But I got over that quickly, and I realized, well, you know, I don't know if I can compete with him or not. But, you know, this guy is part of the miracle, too, because he's raised the bar. And I think that's what was great about Crum. Crum really came in and raised the bar. So he made us all go, like, look, you know, yeah, we can compete with him, but if we're going to compete with him, it's going to be something a lot better than we ever realized. And I think his influence made us all just that much better than we might have been.
Okay. What's interesting about this time is that all you guys are still in it, working in it, you know? I'm Jeff Ford. This is Brookdale's Writer Series, and we'll be right back in a minute.
AIDS has killed more children worldwide than there are in all the grade schools in New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Washington, Atlanta, and Miami combined. The time to do something is now.
Welcome back to Brookdale's Writer Series. I'm your host, Jeff Ford. Today our guest is Kim Deitch, graphic novelist and alternative comics creator. We'll get back to the conversation.
Right.
One of the things I wanted to ask you is, when did you have a sense, I get a sense from your work that you have really created a world, the comics that you, a lot of them seem to interact in the same world, and I was wondering if you had that sense about them, and with what comics that started? Like, does that go back to Miles Mycroft, the detective, or do you not feel that way about them?
I do feel that way about them, but it wasn't like that it just came on me at the beginning that this is what was going on. I think it just came on me in the way that, even though you're creating fiction, if it's going to be convincing fiction, you have to sort of take it seriously yourself. There has to be a certain logic to it. And after a while, you know, trying to keep everything logical and other characters crossing into other stories, it just, I think, yeah, a Kim Deitch universe gradually kind of evolved. And I really do try to make sure that everything squares with everything else. But it really was a process of evolution.
Okay. When did you come up with first have the idea for Waldo, who's a character of a cat who shows up in a lot of your work? When did you get that idea, and how?
How I got it and when? I would say it's about 1966 when I was sort of evolving out of fine art and into comics. And, you know, I thought, well, comics is great. I really like to do it. It's just one little problem, you know. It wasn't like I could draw all that well, and I wasn't really sure I could handle a human figure all that well, whereas I thought, well, you know, maybe a cartoon cat. The kind of cartoons I grew up watching were mostly on TV. They were mostly cartoons from the 20s, and they mostly had just like hundreds of black cats running around in them, and I thought, well, yeah, maybe like one of those old black cats like in the old Aesop's Fables cartoons, you know, that I could get by with that. And so in my early experiments I was using that cat, but then as things rolled along the cat started to pick up a personality, you know, and so he just sort of grew like Topsy, you know. It just happened, you know, until finally, you know, he's got a whole backstory too, which is preposterous, but, you know, like, basically at this point, it turns out that Waldo is the reincarnation of Judas Iscariot. When Judas went to hell and became a demon for years and years, you know, Waldo only got reborn when some witch was doing some black magic at around the turn of the century and accidentally charged him out from hell, and here he is now.
He plays an important part in the comics, though, because he has this kind of ironic... you know, this kind of, he's like a foil for the action of the story a lot of times. A lot of times the characters, you're not sure if he's real in the story or a figment of the character's imagination.
Yeah.
He always plays this character of like a foil, like a, not a commentator, but comments on the story and his actions and what he does and so forth. You know, it's also what he says a lot of times. You know?
Yeah, I'm finding he's turning out to be a really good MC, too, for comics that have nothing else to do with him. He's just a good spokesman. I sort of like to use him because he's constantly surprising me. You know, in a way, he's sort of almost like a meaner version of me. You know? And I don't know. He has a certain life of his own. One interesting thing I will say about him is, like, he's not a character I go out of my way to use. I've never forced a story. I never just said, well, I'm going to do a Waldo story. I only do one if I think I have a legitimately good idea in the first place.
Okay. Since this is a writer series, in comics there is a lot of writing.
Oh, yeah.
And I think you're probably one of the best writers in the alternative comics field. The stories are, I think, the most literary. That have the most literary device in them, where you have metafictional devices of stories within stories, and can you talk a little bit about about writing for comics and how that differs from, you know, you read quite a bit, how that differs from would differ from a novel?
Yeah, well, it is different from a novel. I mean, with me, the interesting thing about it is that when I'm drawing and writing a comic, the drawing helps the writing, and vice versa. Like, usually when I'm writing a story, it will start out as notes and stuff, but an interesting thing that happens is I'm also drawing at the same time, and like, if I'm writing along and I'm stuck on a certain point, what I'll often do is stop, and where I'm stuck at exactly that point, I'll just sit down and just start trying to draw the most detailed drawing of exactly what's going on at right about the place where I'm stuck. And that does an interesting thing. It kind of lets my mind relax. I think it kind of brings my subconscious mind into play, because more often than not, it's kind of amazing how I'll be sitting there trying to get the shading just right on this drawing. But while I'm doing that, just about the time I've sort of let go of my problem, that's when I'm starting to get the revelation of what happens next.
Yeah.
So both are going on in tandem at the same time.
I know in Waldo World, you know, the beginning of that is there's a lot of writing in the beginning where you're kind of like an illuminated manuscript where there's text and then pictures interspersed throughout the text, which is a piece of Boulevard of Broken Dreams now, right? Yeah. Have you ever thought of doing a book that's just that format where you have, I know Phoebe Glockner has done a book.
That was a big influence.
Have you thought about trying to do
definitely,
something like that?
Yeah. I've definitely considered it. You know, part of that comes out of the fact that another one of my big influences, I like to read a lot, but I've really got kind of fascinated and interested in the illustrated Victorian novels, particularly the ones of Dickens and Thackeray. Because, like, you know, Dickens was like his own art director. Every picture you see in those, at least the editions that were done when he was alive, he chose the exact place where those illustrations were supposed to appear.
Oh, is that right?
And Thackeray in Vanity Fair, if you get the original version, it has 190 illustrations by Thackeray.
You know,
it's unbelievable to me that anybody would reprint that book without printing the illustrations. And so that's, you know, kind of, you know, when I first started doing that, in a way, it was sort of an homage to that illustrated English fiction. Plus, you know, when you read those, you can actually, in some cases, see, you know, comics kind of evolving out of them. Like, for instance, a lesser English novel, Jack Shepherd by Harrison Ainsworth, it was illustrated by George Cruikshank. They're mostly, you know, single picture etching plates in the book, but at one point he has to describe Jack Shepherd's jailbreak, and he can't quite do it in one picture, so he's cut it up into three panels, and it's like, hey, you know, it's actually happening before your eyes, you know, the beginning of comics.
What other artists now, comics creators, do you feel are good writers in the field that you...
Well, there's a lot of them. Well, I think the Canadian artist Seth is rather good. A lot of the Canadian boys are good.
Yeah.
Dan Clowes is a darn good writer. Chris Ware is good. Art Spiegelman, you know, Mouse, that was a big influence on me, you know. Right.
I know it's one of your other influences in your work is it kind of has a retro look to it. I don't know if that term is the right term, but it has it has a look to it that utilizes imagery from the 30s, the 20s, 30s, films, animation from that time period, like Fleischer Brother movies and those kind of things. Is that why do you think you gravitate toward that look? Do you have
just a big history fan for one thing, and I just almost from the day I was popped out of my mother. I've always just been terribly fascinated by, in particular, the early 20th century. I almost feel like I must be reincarnated from somebody around that period because it's absolutely obsessive how I'm drawn to it.
Okay. In the most recent graphic novel in Boulevard of Broken Dreams, you really talk about the history of animation. I mean, that's basically the understory of that whole novel.
Yeah.
It seems to me that one of the things that you're discussing is where animation really split and went wrong, became Disneyfied.
Yeah, that's that was one of the issues.
Could you talk about that a little bit?
Well, I grew up around the animation business. I was running around these cartoon studios when I was so little. I didn't even quite know what a cartoon was. So, you know, breakfast table talk around, you know, was Dad kvetching about some cornball Disney stuff, you know, which, you know, he had a sort of a love-hate relationship with, as do a lot of us.
Yeah.
So that's why I did that book, is that I grew up around the business. I knew a lot of people in it. I mean, hundreds of people in it. So at some point, it was just inevitable I was going to draw upon that stuff for story ideas.
Do you see animation changing now? I mean, has it ever regained what it's lost by becoming like just a children's medium in this country, a lot of times infantile medium?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I think it's changing for the better right now, and I'll tell you why. I think one thing that's happening that's terribly exciting is all this computer stuff, these flash programs and stuff, because suddenly animation has become eminently doable. Like an individual could make a cartoon, you know. It isn't like that you gotta spend as much money to do it. So that subtle thing, I think, could open up animation terrifically in the coming years.
Okay. When you decide to sit down and do a comic, what kind of tools do you use? Like, what kind of things do you, you know, pens, whatever, oh. You know, any kind of tools? I'm happy to tell you. I wouldn't think about that you might use to...
I can give you the basic rundown. I mean, first of all, a light board is a must because it's amazing how when you're doing sketches, you can get it just right on the first sketch and then you try to redraw it later. It tends to stiffen up. So basically I use a light board. I usually draw my layouts on Xerox paper and then I trace them off on two-ply Bristol board, two-ply because you want to be able to see through to that light board. And I ink them generally, I trace them off with a very light pencil and then I ink with, that's my one extravagance. I really like to use really good brushes. I mostly use Winsor Newton.
You ink everything with a brush?
90%, more than you'd imagine. You know, I letter with a rapidograph, and I might throw a little bit of drawing in with them occasionally. And I have a dip pen for certain little effects. But really, I'd say maybe 96% is brushes. They're mostly Winsor Newton Series 7s. There's also a brush called Raphael that are a little cheaper than that, okay. that I think are pretty good.
We're getting near the end, so I wanted to ask you, what's the current project that you're working on now?
Currently, I'm finishing a series... Well, here it is. Is this the camera over here? Stuff of Dreams. I'm doing Stuff of Dreams 3, which will complete. It's really not all. It's really a series of stories, but that's what I'm working on currently. And what might be interesting from your perspective is the fact that in Stuff of Dreams, I'm using an awful lot of stuff that has to do with the folklore of New Jersey.
Okay.
Because there's an awful lot of interesting stuff going on in this state. My wife is a Jersey girl, so I spend a certain amount of time over here.
Okay, I'm Jeff Ford. Thanks a lot, Kim.
My pleasure,
Jeff. Thank you for watching Brookdale's Writer Series, and we'll see you next time.